So, let us get started with a brief introduction of how the brain works and how we can draw inspiration from the brain towards designing neural networks. The brain is a complicated organ, as we all know, and one of the important regions of the brain is the cerebrum. And the cerebrum has a lot of interesting functional areas that lead from the voluntary movement to the memory and functioning. For example, if you look at this pink shaded area, so this is where the voluntary movement happens. This region controls voluntary movement. Then there is sensory association, where there is integration of sensory information, and that is this region here. And then there is visual association for vision processing, and that is this region here that you see in this light green shade. And then there is primary visual cortex, language comprehension area, which is this region. There is also auditory association areas, which are these regions here. And we also have emotions, learning and memory, and this is this region here, which is a red shaded region, the olfactory cortex, speech formation, so on and so forth. So, there are a lot of interesting functionalities, from motor control to thoughts to emotions, behavior, etcetera, that the brain controls. And this is through a complicated chemical electrical message exchange process. So, this is a very important information processing engine of the human body, where there is communication, computing and control. At the core of the brain is the neuron at the most fundamental step, right. So, this is a sort of a schematic of a neuron, a biological visualization. So, this has an axon, then there is this nucleus, and there are dendrites, which are these branching sort of terminals, and this is the axon length, which has axon terminals, where there are synaptic vesicles, which release chemical messengers that are passed through a synaptic junction to the next neuron and so forth. So, the neuron is a very important fundamental unit of the brain. And why are we interested in neurons? Because we are interested in biophysical models or plausible mathematical models, which are realistic, wherein we can bring in networks. Now, when you think about the brain, there is communication, computation and control. And one can think of the human brain, or in general a mammalian brain, as a massive parallel distributed information processing engine. I gave a brief introduction regarding the analogies between the human brain and the silicon equivalent during the introductory lecture, but let me briefly again touch upon this aspect. The human brain has about 100 billion neurons and about 100 trillion synapses. The weight is about 1.5 to 2 kilograms in an adult human brain. The conduction speed of a nerve impulse can be from 0.6 meters per second to about 120 meters per second. It consumes 20% of the body power, and interestingly, it is about 10 power minus 16 joules per operation per second. That is the kind of wattage of power it takes. And the transport phenomenon is through ion exchange process. I would say it is an electrochemical process, because there are cycles of ion exchange and electrical signals that are conducted through the neurons. The operating temperature is 37 plus minus 2 degrees centigrade, otherwise we have fever and you know, we cannot function. It is an amazing fault tolerant system. Error correction is sort of ingrained within the human brain. the firing of the neurons is asynchronous, and we know from circuits and systems that asynchronous systems do not have an inbuilt clock, and therefore we have a power reduction automatically. So this is sort of an inspiration that we can draw from biology, and we need 7.5 to 8 hours of good sleep to function. Okay. Now this is a sort of a schematic, biological schematic of a neuron. So a typical neuron comprises of a soma, which is this bulbous cell body containing the nucleus. This is the nucleus, the green portion is the nucleus, this is a bulbous cell body, and we have these dendrites sort of like the antlers of a reindeer, right. They are long filament like branching structures that are attached to the cell body, and we can think of sensory inputs at the input of these dendrites. So these are sensory inputs. We have a single axon, which is sort of like the transmission line that we are aware of in electrical systems, and this is about 1000 times the size of what the axon is in terms of length, and each axon terminal has many small vesicles. These are axon terminals, and they have these small sacs like these, right. They are called vesicles or sacs that release neurotransmitters which bind to the chemical receptors at the receiving neuron. I will get into the details when I talk about synapses. Now how do we do information processing in the brain? There are many stages to this. The first step is the information transmission. So this works using a combination of chemical messaging and electrical signals during memory encoding and recall. This is the heart of it. So whenever we have to store patterns, we have to recall patterns, there is some encoding happening there, and because of which there is information transmission. Action potential. Each neuron maintains a potential gradient across its membrane due to varying ionic concentrations of sodium, potassium, chlorine, calcium ions within the cell as a result of various metabolic activities, right. It can be anabolism, it can be catabolism. So we have various metabolic activities, and because of which we have varying ionic concentrations. If the voltage changes significantly, an electrochemical pulse called an action potential is generated, and this is measured as a brain wave with a rhythmic pattern. And if you look into projects such as the Connectome project or the Human Brain project, there are biophysical models for these neurons, and I encourage interested readers to take a look into these projects to learn biophysical models and see how we can sort of mathematically abstract a biological neuron to as close to reality as possible. The next is synapse. The next term is synapse. The electrical pulse travels rapidly along the axon, and I mentioned to you that this axon is like a transmission line, and this electrical pulse is transferred to a dendrite of a connecting neuron through what we call a synapse. A synapse is a complex membrane gap which is about 20 nanometers, and this is used to transmit signals between neurons. And this transfer is also called synaptic connection, and typically we can think of axon dendrite synaptic connections, but there are also dendrite to dendrite connections, etc. So things are more complicated, but typically we think about connections between the axon and the dendrite. And a typical neuron fires 5 to 50 times a second. This is an important thing. Now, we have these neurons. We are interested in connecting these neurons together to formulate neural networks in the artificial sense. But what is it from the biological perspective? Each neuron can form thousands of links with other neurons, forming typically about 100 trillion synapses, forming neural networks. These are biological neural networks. And based on this evidence, we would also like to develop artificial neural networks which are motivated through these ideas. The connections between neurons are dynamic in the biological world. This is very important, and the connection improves with every memory experience. We see things, they get reinforced. For example, the first time I see a red color here, it just registers, but I may forget over time, and this can be reinforced again and again if I keep seeing the same thing, and then that forms into my permanent memory. Okay. And the other thing is the connections are dynamic. Some of the links are broken, new connections can be formed. So, can this be inspirational to the design of artificial neural networks? This is very important. Can we develop neural networks that are dynamic as we see data and as things are reinforced? Can we form new connections? Can we remove dead neurons and weed them out? So, these are some of the important aspects in the design of neural networks. Next is the ion exchange channels. Each axon terminal contains thousands of membrane bound sacs containing neurotransmitters, which are chemical messengers that relay, amplify and modulate signals between neurons and other cells. So, this is quite different when you think about the silicon counterpart, because it happens through electron hole transportation process, because we have transistors there, right. So, here it is chemical messaging. When excited by an electrical pulse, various neurotransmitters are released. They diffuse across the cell membrane into the synaptic gap between neurons binding to the chemical receptors on the dendrites of the receiving neuron. Now, during this process, the cell permeability to specific ions gets altered. This is very important, because this is where the conduction channel opens or closes to specific ions. It is sort of like a filter, and one can think about it like a communication channel with chemical messaging. And this leads to ion specific channels. Okay. Now, the potential at the receiving neuron is altered, leading to a new electrical signal in the receiving neuron, and this whole process is less than 1 to 2 milliseconds. In this way, a message within the brain goes through a cycle of electrical and chemical messaging process, and there is communication, there is computation, there is also control, because control comes through the external stimulus, right. So, this is a magnificent system where there is information communication technology imbibed into a biological system. It is a very complex system. We think this is slow, but this is massively parallel and distributed. So, we have a very high throughput, unlike what we see with silicon systems. So, our goal is artificial neural networks. That is our primary goal within this course. ANNs are inspired from information processing tasks within the brain to empower machines with human-like intelligence. One can think of two categories for ANNs. ANNs can be inspired from biophysical models, or we can imbibe biophysical models within artificial neural networks that can lead to neuromorphic circuits and systems. This is an active area of research. Suppose we want to endow a robot that can have vision like humans, that can speak like humans, maybe even sing music like humans, right? Then we have to understand how biophysical processes work and sort of bring in biophysical models. ANNs need not use biophysical models. A neuronal model can be mathematically abstracted using a nonlinear function with inputs, an activation function that can describe the outputs, right? We can use a nonlinear function with inputs and an activation function to describe the outputs. And once we formulate the model of the neuron, be it a biophysical model or a mathematical model which is bio-inspired, these neurons can be assembled to form networks, and we call them neural networks, and we can evolve a hierarchy of layered neural network architectures to accomplish complex learning tasks. Okay. So, with this we start our journey, because we are inspired by how the brain works and we are interested in formulating networks and systems towards learning tasks.